Each week at this time, Lucky Strike offers you the chance to match your wits against those of four mental wizards. You provide the questions and our experts try to answer them. Remember, under the new arrangement, for every question used, Lucky Strike will give you not only $10 in war stamps, but a set of the 12-volume Britannica Junior Encyclopedia. If the question is muffed, you get the Junior Britannica plus a $50 war bond plus a 24-volume set of the regular Encyclopedia Britannica. Send your questions to Information Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. If our editorial staff edits your questions a bit, don't fret over it. In case of similarity, we'll have to be sole judge of who shall be paid. And all questions become the property of Information Please. And now light up a lucky strike as I present our master of ceremonies, book reviewer of the New Yorker magazine, Clifton Fadiman. Mr. Fadiman.
Thank you, Mr. Trump. Ladies and gentlemen, Information Please, from the beginning, has been a completely spontaneous and unrehearsed program, and we'll continue in that groove, maybe forever. Now, tonight, our veterans, John Kiernan and Franklin P. Adams, are here, and we have two guests. First, our old friend, the eminent novelist and critic, Christopher Morley, and the other, the versatile genius of stage and screen, the director and producer of the magnificent Ambersons, the one and only Orson Welles. Now, Mr. Welles, as I understand it, you have a bet with the producer of our little show, whereby, if you miss any question, our producer is forced to buy a $500 war bond. Is that right? For himself, of course. Is that correct?
Well, you say it with such assurance, I'm sure that it is.
Yes. Well,
he claims it's true.
It is true. Our producer is going to buy a $500 war bond for himself and the kiddies if Mr. Welles misses any question. So, Mr. Welles, this evening there will be a contest in your mind between your honesty and your patriotism. I don't know what you're going to win. We'll begin with a question from Dorothy Sawyer of New York. Here are three examples of frightfulness. Identify each one. Let's get two out of three if we can. Whose name, gentlemen, was used at one time to frighten the children of England? Mr. Welles?
King Bogey.
And who was that? King Bogey or the Bogeyman?
King Bogey is the original of the Bogeyman.
He was the first of the Bogeys?
Yes.
Was there a Bogey the first and Bogey the second and
no,
Bogey the third?
No dynasty, just His Majesty.
That is true. They did have a Bogey. We frightened them with a Bogeyman, but there was an actual person who was used to frighten the children of England, Mr. Morley.
I was thinking of Boney.
Yes, by a change of a single letter, you get Boney. Who was Boney, Mr. Morley?
Napoleon Bonaparte.
Yes, this was during his threatened invasion of England. That Napoleon Bonaparte.
King Bogey goes back further. Though.
I'm sure it does. I think chronologically you came before Mr. Morley. But that's the only way. How about this one? Who frightened a nation with a new strange animal? This, again, is true history. Who frightened a nation with a new strange animal? Mr. Welles.
Cortez.
Oh, very good. That's quite right. How? What sort of animal was that?
A horse.
Yes. Had the Aztecs ever seen a horse in their lives?
No.
No, and they thought that the... Men riding
also Pizarro in Peru.
I imagine the same thing. Yes. Mr. Morley?
Hannibal with elephants.
Yes, I guess that's right, too.
Did it scare him?
Sure, it was the origin of the tank.
Took a long time. How about this one? Who frightened the inhabitants of Grover's Mills, New Jersey? Oh, I have two hands on that. I think I'll take Mr. Adams.
Mr. W.
Yes, our eminent friend. Yes, do you remember that, Mr. Welles?
It comes back to me.
Vaguely. Mr. Welles, have you had any success in scaring people ever since that famous Martian broadcast of yours?
No, naturally, everything is anticlimactic.
Anticlimactic. Well, you were too good at
maybe
it.
Maybe now people scare him.
It's very possible. Doesn't look it, though.
It's in the present instant.
Oh, no, I don't believe it at all. Well, that gives us 3 out of 3. Gentlemen are very good on frightfulness. Now, how about this, Rhoda and Saul Rice. So, by the way, you know, this week is back to school week, and it's as good a time as any to think about the kiddies, God bless them. In the spirit of the season, therefore, Lucky Strike, as you know, gives away a 12-volume set of the Junior Encyclopedia Britannica to every person whose question is used on this program. That's in addition to the $10 in war stamps. So with the Junior Encyclopedia in the house, every American family can henceforth raise its own small Kieran. God forbid. The Rices of New York City who send in this question get that Junior Encyclopedia for the little Rices. How about this? Name the movie and at least one of the stars, shall we say, of the pictures that had these plots. I'm going to tell you the plots. And you tell me the name of the movie and the name of the star. Here's the first. The unwilling object of the passionate embraces of the young Bedouin. She is about to plunge a dagger into her heart when she learns he is not a nomadic tribesman, but an Englishman, whereupon she swoons into his arms. Mr. Kieran.
Would that be Valentino?
Valentino is right.
The Sheik.
In the Sheik, yes. Rudolph Valentino and Agnes Ayres in the Sheik. About how far back does that go?
Oh, to my boyhood almost.
That's the pre... Mr. Wells?
Doesn't go back that far. The Sheik is... The Sheik is a motion picture.
Doesn't it even go back to pre-Wells period? You must have been a boy.
I remember the Sheik and the son of the Sheik both very well.
You do remember both
yes.
of them? At what time did you begin to remember things, Mr. Wells?
What's more pertinent is when I began to forget them.
Now, how about this one? See if you can remember this. Here's another movie plot. She cringes before her father's angry whip, suffocates in a closet, is pursued by a band of crooks along a riverbank, flings herself this way and that, and at the end she is killed by her own father. Don't be too affected, gentlemen. Can I get you out of that stupor, Mr. Morley? Remember that at all? Mr.
That
Wells?
Must have been since my time.
Mr. Wells, your memory goes back to a very early period. Almost embarrassingly early, I suppose. Broken Blossoms,
That's
Lillian
right.
Gish. Remember it now, Mr. Wells?
Indeed.
Yes, Broken Blossoms That's with Lillian right. Gish, a very fine picture for its day. Or wasn't it, Mr. Wells?
It was a very fine picture. It was the first Sweet Griffith, though.
The first Sweet Griffith?
Yeah.
Is that what you call him in the trade?
No, I call him in the trade.
How about this? A wicked vampire makes the head of a happy household the slave of temptation. And in spite of two attempts to return to his family, he follows her to a point of degradation and finally dies clutching one of her garments. Mr. Morley.
It must have been Theda Bara.
That's very good. Yes, it was Theda Bara.
But which garment it was, I don't remember.
Well, you've got the right star, all right. Now, what was the name of the picture? Mr. Kieran? I can tell you it's the name of a beginning of a poem by Kipling.
Vampire.
Mr. Wells.
Yeah.
A fool there was.
Yeah.
By Porter Emerson Brown.
That's right. Well, that gives us 2 out of 3. Thank you, gentlemen. How about this one from Mrs. Helen E. Masterson of Akron, Ohio? Here are the closing lines of some famous poems. What are the opening lines? I give you the last line. You give me the opening ones. Here's the closing line of the first. I never writ, nor no man ever loved. Mr. Kieran?
That is the last of Shakespeare's sonnets. I think it's about 116.
No, it isn't. It's exactly 26. 116.
Oh, isn't it?
Not about 116. Mr. Kieran, how does it begin?
Well, that's what I'm trying to think in a hurry.
Mr. Morley, want to help out, Mr. Kieran?
Let me not to the marriage of true minds.
No.
Mr.
Admit
Wells?
Impediments.
Well, it's not long which alteration
finds.
That's right.
How about it, Mr. Wells?
Depends of the remover to remove. I would have said it was another sign.
That's a good thing you didn't.
Oh, no, love is
right,
never fixed
right.
mark that looks so intense.
Beg your pardon, stage.
Very fine.
10 lines to go yet, these boys.
All right, try this one. Here's the closing line of another famous poem. How does it open? Mirth, with thee I mean to live. Mr. Adams.
Milton.
Yes. What poem and how does it open?
L'Allegro.
Allegro, how does it open? That's quite right. Mr. Kieran?
Haste thee, nymph, and bring with thee jest and youthful jollity and so forth and so on.
Well, that's...
That's in it.
That's in it. Well, how does it open, Mr. Kieran? Those are famous lines. Mr. Wells, has it come back to you?
I'm just stroking my forehead.
Something about cockcrow.
Hence, loathed melancholy of Cerberus and blackest midnight born in Stygian cave and so forth. I hardly think that I can give you full credit on that, gentlemen. Though, between you, you got the author and the poem. Now, how about this one? Here's the last line. What's the opening line? With a fearful shriek, he leaped and fell across the picture dead. Mr. Wells?
Last Duchess. Huh?
Not by a long shot. Mr. Morley?
It was down in somebody's barroom by the corner of the square.
Oh, boy.
Yes. Face on the barroom floor.
Face on the floor.
Face on the floor.
Face upon the floor. Yes. How did it open?
It was a balmy summer's evening.
And a goodly crowd was there. That's quite right, Mr.
Somebody's bar in the corner of the square.
By the way, Mr. Wells, if Mr. Robert Browning is listening in to you, you've lost a friend.
True.
That gives us... Don't let it depress you. That gives us 2 out of 3. How about this one from A.L. Thirst of New York? Now, in order to reach each of these places that I'll name, a person, in fact or in fiction, crossed a river. Name the river, name the person. And let's get 3 out of 4. Now, the first place is Jericho. Who crossed what river to get to Jericho? Mr. Kieran?
I think Joshua went to Jericho.
He did indeed. That's
and
quite
I
right.
I think he crossed the Jordan.
That's exactly right, Mr. Kieran.
Joshua. And the walls came tumbling down.
Yes, if this were Mr. Henderson's evening, Adams, it would be better for you. How about Harper's Ferry? Who crossed what river, Mr. Morley?
John Brown went to Harper's Ferry, and he might have crossed either the Potomac or...
Stop there.
Well, there's another river that comes in right there.
I guess there
The question is wrong. The question is wrong because Brown was in, did not have to cross the river to get to Harper's Ferry, but had spent a year there in the district before Harper's Ferry, the incident of Harper's Ferry. In other words, he did not march on it or cross a river to the arsenal.
You sound as if you're there yourself, Mr. Wells. Mm-hmm. Is
that
really
right?
True?
That's absolutely right. He lived in a farmer's house.
I think that's right.
Stayed in a farmer's house in the district and would not have had to cross a river to get to the arsenal.
Of course, you know you're upsetting this entire program. But I think that's true.
Yeah, it is true.
Okay.
But you didn't give us any time limit.
How about this one? Who crossed what river to get to Trenton? Mr. Kieran?
That would be General George Washington.
Yes, and the river being...
Well, he crossed the,
We all know that. Mr. Kieran, goodness gracious. Why?
Delaware.
The Delaware, yes, crossed the Delaware. But Mr. Kieran, I think I'm going to test you further. Was that the same river that he threw the dollar across?
No, that was the Rappahannock.
Have you got any inside information, Mr. Wells?
Or the Potomac.
Potomac.
Or both.
I thought it was the Rappahannock.
No, Potomac.
Well, maybe we'll hear from the Rappahannock.
He lived down
in
the Potomac.
Who crossed what river to get to Sandusky? Mr. Adams?
Eliza Harris.
Eliza Harris, very good.
Crossed the Ohio River.
Yes.
To get to Sandusky, and there was ice in the river.
There was ice in the river, yes.
A number of wolves.
And a chase around.
Harriet Beecher Stowe.
Yes, that's right. Well, that gives us... We'd get 3 out of 4 on that, thank you. We got 3 out of 4, and... Mr. Wells corrected us on one of our questions. I don't know who gets the $50 bond on this one. How about this from Margaret Janso of South Bend, Indiana? Identify the fictional character who did the following things. These are all people who had a good deal to do with saloons and bars and such places. Identify the character who philosophized in his little saloon. It's a very cute little saloon. Mr. Wells?
Mr. Dooley?
Mr. Dooley, yes. Right. That was way before your time, Mr. Wells. How do you know these things?
The saloon's still there.
Try this one, gentlemen. The character who bragged and boasted of his courage in a tavern. Mr. Wells.
Foster.
Do any other of you gentlemen care to answer any of these questions? How about this one? That's correct. Who listened to information, please, at a bar? Oh, everybody, of course. Mr. Kieran?
That was in the Woman of the Year. The big moving picture actor. Very nice fellow and very good actor.
Yes, that's right. Very good actor.
Who was playing the hero?
Spencer Tracy. Yes, the character's name was Sam. And the picture opened, did it not, with him listening to information, please, over the radio. Very fine opening for... Pretty good picture, too. Now, let's see. Mr. Cross points out one thing, that time does not change.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it was true of the first cigarette that was ever smoked, and it's just as true today. In a cigarette, it's the tobacco that counts. Yes, better tobacco makes a better cigarette. That's one good solid fact about smoking that never changes. And smokers, another fact that has been true year after year is that Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. At auctions all over the South, when the finer, lighter, milder leaf, the real Lucky Strike leaf, comes up for sale, we consistently pay the price to get this better tobacco that means a better smoke for you. Indeed, ladies and gentlemen, the simple phrase, Lucky Strike means fine tobacco, sums up the whole story of Lucky Strike, so round, so firm, so fully packed, so free and easy on the draw. Mr. Fadiman, have I made clear that Lucky's give smokers what really counts, fine tobacco, so free and easy on the draw?
Mr. Cross, in 58 seconds, you've put the fact squarely on the line. And now we'll go on with a question that comes to us from a very famous name indeed. One of the great detectives of our time is named Ellery Queen, although I believe he's the invention...
Two of the great detectives.
Well, he's the invention of two other fellows. And he has written in a question about other famous detectives. And Mr. Morley, I believe you're generally considered an expert on thrillers. We shall expect some brilliant work from you. What famous detective never revealed his first name? His first name. These are going to be about names and detectives. Mr. Morley?
The first one that occurs to me is Lecoq.
I don't remember whether there is a first name there or not. Now, you certainly...
I never heard of it.
More of an expert than I am, Mr. Morley. You may be quite right, Mr. Wells.
Father Brown.
Father Brown is the one I was thinking of, yes. In the G.K. Chesterton, very brilliant stories, Father Brown never gives us his first name. What famous detective, on the other hand, gloried in many names, had many aliases? That's not so easy. Mr. Morley?
There was a fellow called Cleek of the 40 Faces.
Who wrote the book?
Thomas W. Hanshew.
Oh, this is deep stuff. Wow, this is way out of my depth.
Published by Doubleday, Page and Company.
You got me there.
When I was a boy out there.
And he had many names in the stories?
He had many faces, and I suppose the name went with each face that I don't remember.
It seems only reasonable.
I had to sell the remainder.
Mr. Kieran?
Hawkshaw, the detective.
Hawkshaw? You mean the comic strip character?
He was always appearing in disguise.
Comic strip, indeed.
No.
He's a famous figure of the American theater, Hawkshaw.
Wasn't he always using... No, he had phony names and disguises.
Yeah.
Well, what's wrong with calling a section of the American theater a comic strip? A good deal of it is these days, Mr. Wells, isn't it? Miss Gypsy Rose Lee, I mean, that sort of... Well, we have to descend to those things in this program once in a while. Now, you may be right, Mr. Morley, and very probably are. I was thinking of Arsène Lupin, the famous French detective who had a number of other names, Leblanc and Prince Ronin, Louis Perrenat.
Basically a thief, though, Arsène Lupin.
Was he?
Not a detective.
A rascal?
He was a thief and then a detective.
Yes, he was a Raffles kind of fellow.
Well, he was
basically a jewel thief who sometimes solved problems, but usually simply was cleverly evaded the cops.
You wouldn't call him a detective?
No.
All right, I guess we'll add that to that confounded river that Mr. John Brown never crossed.
Yeah.
Great
escape artist.
It seems to me that I'm going to call that wrong, Mr. Morley, subject to correction at a later time. Call you wrong.
Oh.
You may be right. But give Ellery Queen a chance, the poor fellow. What famous detective had no name at all? Oh, this is very tough. I think Ellery Queen is challenging you fellows to a terrific game of wits and erudition. Mr. Morley, any idea at all? It's a story by the Baroness Ochse. Wrote a book called The Old Man in the Corner. And you know of him only as the old man in the corner. Well, that sends a $50 war bond to Ellery Queen.
It's a little abstruse, though.
A little abstruse. I think so, Mr. Morley. And a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Thank you very much. What Ellery Queen is going to do with Encyclopedia Britannica, I have no idea. Here's one from James B. Zabin of New York City. This is a serious geographical question, gentlemen. The United States, let us assume, is to help construct a highway linking the United States and Panama. Name five of the nations that lie between this country and Panama. Actually, there are six, I believe, and we can all get together on this. Mr. Wells, you want to start us off?
Mexico.
Mexico is right.
Guatemala.
Guatemala is right.
Honduras.
Very good.
San Salvador.
Very good.
Dominican Republic. No, I'm wrong. Dominican Republic's an island.
I didn't hear you say Dominican Republic.
No, thank you.
Mr. Morley?
Nicaragua.
Nicaragua.
Yes, that gives us five of them. I think, how about British Honduras? Which is different from Honduras.
Yes, Honduras.
And also there's Costa Rica. That would give us seven. Well, we got five out of the seven. And that little extra one that you added on, Mr. Wells,
I was clearing my throat.
Yes, sir, I realize. What I like about the way you clear your throat is the way you syllabificate it. Tell every syllable. How about this one from Mrs. Ruth Newland of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania? This one about people who slept a long time. Who slept for 42 hours? 42 hours. Mr. Wells, you say you have on occasion? This is a fictional character. Although maybe that doesn't apply at that.
Somebody who fought against Dempsey, but I can't remember who it was.
No, it was Juliet. Remember, she was put to sleep by the potion in Romeo and Juliet. Isn't it the friar who says in this borrowed likeness of shrunk death, thou shalt continue 2 and 40 hours? Mr. Wells, has it come back to you?
No.
You never played Juliet? How about this? Who slept for 20 years? 20 years, Mr. Adams?
R.V. Winkle.
R.V. Winkle. That's right. By W. Irving. Who slept for 100 years? Going up, boys. Who slept for 100 years? Mr. Kieran?
I think the Sleeping Beauty.
Sleeping Beauty, yes. And how was she awakened?
By a kiss from Prince Charming, who came along.
Yes, by a kiss from Prince Charming. Very good. How about this one? Mrs. Rufus Jones of New York City sends in this one about landladies, famous landladies of fiction. What landlady had a retired army surgeon and a narcotic addict as boarders? Mr. Morley?
Mrs. Hudson at 221B Baker Street.
You sound as if you'd lived there yourself, Mr. Morley. Yes. It's the address, one of the most famous addresses.
Of Sherlock Holmes.
Of Sherlock Holmes, yes. And, of course, the retired army surgeon.
Dr. Watson.
Yes, and Sherlock Holmes, the narcotic addict. What landlady of fiction saw her son go off to sea when one of her boarders died? One of her boarders died, and directly thereafter, her son went off to sea in one of the most famous stories in English. What story? Mr. Adams?
Might be Moby Dick.
No. No, it is not. And I heard that, too. You weren't clearing your throat.
No, I was not.
Mr. Kieran? What landlady saw her son go off to sea when one of her boarders died?
Aye, that was in Treasure Island.
That's right, Mr. Kieran. Very good. In Treasure Island. Who was her son?
His son was the boy, the hero.
Jim Hawkins.
Yes, Jim Hawkins. And who was the boarder who died?
That was Old Pew, wasn't
yes,
it?
Blind Pew.
No, he was not the boarder. No.
Wasn't he?
Pew was a visitor.
There goes that John Brown fellow again.
That's right.
Go ahead, Mr. Wells.
No, I'm out on a limb. I can't think of his name. Give me a bottle of rum, boy.
Oh, no, he didn't die.
Yes, he did. Died in horrible agony. It was Pew that was no boarder. Pew
killed
him. Right. Pew killed him. Gave him the... Gave him the
blind
man. By gosh, I think that's right.
Sure is right.
I think that's right.
Yeah.
It was the other fellow.
Black
the,
Dog, wasn't it?
Oh, the Black Dog was another character with Pew who arrived.
Wells, this is your last appearance on this program. My Lord.
With his chest.
I thought I had enough trouble with Kieran for 4 years. What landlady of fiction... I'm afraid to say anything now. About this. What landlady of fiction sued her boarder for breach of promise? Mr. Wells...
Can't think of her name.
Pickwick
Papers.
That's
Pickwick Papers.
Good.
Her name is Mrs.
Why, everybody knows that.
Bardell.
Well.
Bardell.
Yes, that's exactly right. Everybody had their hands up on that. Mrs. Bardell sued Mr. Pickwick. I guess that gives us 2 out of 3 and gives Mr. Wells 1 out of 1. And now, before we go on, here's Mr. Risedale, who believes that the question, does it earn you your bread and butter, is a good way to test a man's knowledge.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, on the subject of smoking, it's worth your while to listen to men who actually earn their living in buying, selling, and handling tobacco. It's simply common sense. For independent tobacco experts down south, auctioneers, buyers, and warehousemen know tobacco from A to Z. They also know who buys what tobacco, for they see the sales year after year at auctions all over the South. So their overwhelming preference for one cigarette, Lucky Strike, speaks for itself. Indeed, sworn records show that with these experts, with men who know tobacco best, it's Lucky's 2 to 1. Smokers, isn't this tobacco expert's stamp of approval your clear proof that Lucky Strike means fine tobacco? Why not profit by the experience of the experts? Choose a cigarette you know is made of fine tobacco. Choose Lucky Strike. So round, so firm, so fully packed, so free and easy on the draw.
Thank you, Mr. Risedale. That took 59 seconds. And now a question from Randall B. Kester of Portland, Oregon. It's about famous animals of fiction. What animal, I guess you'd call him an animal, used a typewriter? Animal that used a typewriter. Mr. Wells.
Archie.
Oh, who was Archie, Mr. Wells?
Archie was a cockroach.
Yes, he was a cockroach. There still is, matter of fact. Hasn't changed a bit. And he's found in what books?
In the works of Don Marquis.
Yes, some of the funniest books ever written. Mr. Morley, I know you had your hand up because you're an old Marquis fancier. What was the main peculiarity of Mr. Archie's typewriting, Mr. Morley?
He couldn't push down the shift key to work the capital, so it was all done in lowercase.
Yes, and still is.
And he drove on the keys with his head the way many writers do.
Yes, and many writers don't. What animal of fiction was put into a teapot? Animal was put into a teapot, Mr. Kieran.
The March Hare, I believe. The Dormouse.
The Dormouse.
In Alice in Wonderland.
Why is the Dormouse called a Dormouse?
Because he slept. He had a sleepy appearance.
Yes.
Dormouse. French.
Yes, that's right. What animal ate a hat? Ate a hat. It was a hat eater. Hataphage. Mr. Wells? Mr. Wells, don't you remember what animal ate a hat?
I know a man who ate a hat.
Tell us about him some other time. But, well, didn't you produce a play called Horse Eats Hat, Mr. Wells, at one time in your career?
Yes, I did.
You don't remember the you don't remember the things you produced, do you?
That
certainly is not true of the rest of your audience, however. That is rather good, rather nice, yes. Well, that gives us one wrong. Two out of three is okay. I think we'll have time for this one from Francis Shaughnessy of Worcester. Complete these speeches from the tragedies of Shakespeare. This push will chair me ever or deceit me now. I have lived long enough. How does it go on, Mr. Wells?
My way of life has fallen into the sea or the yellow leaf.
That's beautiful, Mr. Wells, and not an easy one. Here's another. When you shall these unlucky deeds relate, speak of me as I am, nothing extenuate, nor set down aught in malice, Mr. Kieran.
But as one who loved not wisely but too well, Othello, the Moor of Venice.
Thank you, Mr. Kieran. That's swell. And how about this one? We at the height are ready to decline. Mr. Wells.
Oh, my God.
Mr. Kieran.
Brutus.
There is a tide in the affairs of men which taken at the flood and so forth.
Thank you, Mr. Kieran and Mr. Wells. Three out of three. And that's all we'll have time for. Lucky Strike is indebted to you, Mr. Morley and Mr. Wells, for lending us your brilliant talents this evening. Now, in a few seconds, I'll announce next week's guests. Tonight, Lucky Strike has paid out one set of the Encyclopedia Britannica and one $50 war bond. And speaking of bonds, let me tell you a short story. There was a town once in Czechoslovakia called Lidice. On June 10th, the Germans murdered its men, imprisoned its women and children, destroyed every stick and stone of the village, and announced the fact proudly to the world. Lidice is a symbol of this war. To prevent the whole world from becoming one great Lidice, buy war bonds and keep on buying. Now, next week, the terrific trio, Adams, Kieran, and Levant, will be here. And as for our guest, we announce by popular request a return engagement of that eminent baritone and director of the Office of Price Administration, Mr. Leon Henderson. Those who are listening, please remember to send your letters with questions, and please don't forget the correct answers to Information, Please, which is at 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. And now we'll listen to a parting message from Mr. L.A. Speed Riggs. Thank you.